باب الاعتكاف للمستحاضة. اعتكاف for the مستحاضة, meaning the woman who is having, who is experiencing استحاضة. Can she do اعتكاف? Yes, she can. Why? Because استحاضة is not حيض. It is different from حيض. And therefore, the regulations of حيض do not apply to استحاضة. حيض, you can say, is a state of impurity in the sense that a woman will not pray at that time and that she needs غسل. But a woman who has استحاضة, she's not in a state of impurity. She can pray. She has to pray, in fact. So when she can pray, that means she can even perform all the other acts of worship. And that includes irtikaf. Even though she is bleeding, even though she may be bleeding profusely, still she can. And the blood of istihada, some have said that it is najis, and this seems to be the majority opinion, the stronger opinion, but still a woman can go to the masjid. Because obviously, where is irtikaf done? In the masjid. So even though there's blood of istihada, yes. Even though that blood may be unclean, yes. She just has to make sure that she does not contaminate the masjid. But otherwise, there is no harm. حدثنا إسحاق قال حدثنا خالد بن عبد الله عن خالد عن إكرمة عن عائشة أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم اعتكف. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم اعتكف, he did اعتكاف. معه بعض نسائه. Along with him were some of his wives. Meaning some wives of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم also did اعتكاف that year in the masjid. And this wife in particular, وهي مستحاضة. She was in the state of استحاضة. ترى الدم. She would see the blood. Meaning it wasn't just a little bit of spotting, but it was actually a lot of bleeding. فربما, then many times, وضعت الطستة. She would place a طستة, the wash basin, you can say like a big bowl or a tub or something like that. She would place it تحتها, under herself, من الدم, because of the blood. Because she would bleed so much that no cloth, no menstrual pad would be sufficient. And it happens with some women that the blood continues to flow. Like as though a tap has been opened up. It just flows and flows and flows uncontrollably. So this is how she would bleed. But she wanted to do irtikaf, so she did it. But what did she do? She placed a wash basin under herself so that the blood would collect over there and the masjid would not get dirty. Wazarma, and the narrator, meaning Ikrima, he asserted that أن عائشة رأت ماء العصفر, that عائشة رضي الله عنها, she saw the water of عصفر. Usfur is safflower, it's a particular kind of flower. So she saw its extract, or its oil you can say, and the color of that was yellowish brown. فقالت, so she said, كَأَنَّ هَذَا شَيْءٌ كَانَتْ فُلَانَةُ تَجِدُهُ, that so-and-so woman, she would find blood or discharge that was something like this, the color of which was something like this. So she compared the blood of istihada like that of safflower liquid. Yellowish brown. So for some women it may be pink, and for others it may be brownish in color. حدثنا قتيبة قال حدثنا يزيد بن زريع عن خالد عن إكرمة عن عائشة قالت, she said, اعتكفت مع رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم امرأة من أزواجه. One of the women from his wives, she did اعتكاف with the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, فكانت ترى الدم والصفرة, and she would see blood as well as صفرة, meaning as well as yellowish discharge. So sometimes it would be very pink, other times it would be dull in its color. So she would see. And it happens that you see a range of colors. وَالطَّسْتُ تَحْتَهَا, and the tast would be under her. Meaning the wash basin would be under her. وَهِيَ تُصَلِّ, and she would also pray. وَهِيَ تُصَلِّ does not mean that she will pray while standing in the tast. Because then how would she do sajda? But what it means is that she would spend her time, most of all, sitting in the wash basin. If she would sit, she would not sit on the floor, but she would sit in that basin. And in her istihada, she would also pray. Meaning, istihada did not prevent her from praying. Istihada did not prevent her from praying. So perhaps when she felt that the blood was slightly controllable, or that she could wear some kind of garment or something, then she would go on and pray. Otherwise, she would spend her time in the fast. Now, there are many things that can be learned over here. That first of all, we see that if due to illness, a woman is bleeding so much that no menstrual pad is enough, or if a person is suffering from salsal bowl, meaning when urine is constantly dripping, meaning a person has problems with their urine, they cannot control it, then they should not delay their prayer, they should not leave their prayer. They will pray as they are, even though they may be bleeding, and even though the urine may be dripping. Because for some people it's beyond their control. They use the washroom right before praying salah. They wash themselves up. They do wudu. But still, the drops come. It's not in their control. So in that case, will they leave the prayer? No. Will they delay the prayer? No. They will pray as they are, even though they may be bleeding and even though the urine drops may be falling out. Because remember, the deen is for all people, for those who are ill and those who are healthy. Those who are suffering from a chronic condition and those who are not. It's for all people. And just because someone has an illness does not mean that they should remain in this guilt, this feeling of, you know, uneasiness. No. You should have this confidence that even though I may be bleeding, it's not in my control, but I will pray still. And I'm not at fault. Also, we see here that her istihada did not prevent her from i'tikaf. And such istihada, that so much blood is coming out. If a woman has a heavy period, what does she do? Lays in bed all the time. Or is just sitting on the couch or not doing anything. Yes, definitely the cramps are there. Understandable. But does it mean that you do nothing? Sometimes I see that girls are, you know, they have really bad cramps or something and they're sitting in the cafeteria sipping on tea. And I say that at least, you know, listen to the class. You can take notes. Okay, get up, walk a little bit, sit down, lie down a little, but don't leave the class. Something that you have to do, you have to do. I mean, you take rest for some time, but then you get up and move on. And never look at yourself as a victim. Whether it's an illness or a circumstance or whatever, never look at yourself as a victim. Because once you start looking at yourself as a victim, then your morale will be down and you won't be able to do anything at all. Always look at such, you know, illness or whatever as a challenge. That, okay, now how do we solve it? How do we deal with it? Okay, what can I do about it? I remember when I was expecting, I had extreme nausea. And there were times when I would be trying to walk into class and I'd be like, my mother was here. I was like, I can't go. She said, it's okay. Put this in your mouth and go to class. And if you have to throw up, just walk out of class. And I would sit in class with a small bowl and a bag that in case I have to throw up, I don't want to dirty the carpet. It was always here. You guys never saw, but it was always here. Why? Because what you have to do, right? And the thing is that once you start looking at the problem, then it becomes even bigger for you. I mean, look at this great woman. She is bleeding profusely. She's sitting in a wash basin in her tent in the masjid. I want to do i'tikaf. I'm going to do it. When you suffer more, you get more reward, right? That after a childbirth, a woman is bleeding for 40 days almost. But throughout that time, she's waking up every 2 hours, every 3 hours to nurse the baby, to change the baby, to burp the baby. So much so that her arms may be hurting, but she's dealing with the bleeding, right? I mean, it's there. It's hurting. She's uncomfortable, but okay. How can I deal with it? Right? This is your attitude then. Focus is something else. Exactly. Don't make your illness or your pain the focus. Don't make it a focus. Like, for example, if you're sick and you have to eat, do you focus on the pain or do you focus on the food? On the food. You don't stop eating just because you're sick. So likewise, you don't stop doing what you have to do just because you are unwell. That it shows the open-heartedness of the Prophet ﷺ and the rest of the people, that even though the wife of the Prophet ﷺ was bleeding profusely, still they let her do i'tikaf in the masjid because she can. So when someone can, even though they may have a condition, you know, they should be allowed to, as long as the arrangements are there. They had the arrangements, a wash basin. If the arrangements cannot be made, then obviously you don't want the person to suffer and you don't want the masjid to suffer. And you don't want the rest of the people to suffer either. So you always have to look at the big picture. If you can accommodate someone, then you accommodate them. But if you cannot accommodate them, then you don't want to, you know, harm them or harm yourself. Imagine that she went ahead and did i'tikaf, and if she hadn't, then how would we know? Self-pity affects your productivity. Obviously, when a woman is in i'tikaf, she is in a separate, you can say, tent. So the wives of the Prophet ﷺ, they had pitched tents in the masjid. So these days you have cubicles, because each person should have some kind of seclusion. Husband and wife should not be in the same cubicle, because it kind of defeats the purpose. حدثنا مسدد قال حدثنا معتمر عن خالد عن إكرمة عن عائشة أن بعض أمهات المؤمنين اعتكفت وهي مستحاضة. That some of the wives of the Prophet ﷺ, they did i'tikaf while they had istihada. And based on this, some scholars have said that non-menstrual vaginal bleeding does not invalidate wudu or prayer. Because if a woman is in i'tikaf, she is praying while she's bleeding, that means that this kind of bleeding does not invalidate wudu. People say that there's no i'tikaf for women. Of course, women can do i'tikaf, and even if a woman having istihada, still she can do i'tikaf. It's a clear evidence. But again, when the arrangements are there, if a masjid does not have that facility, they can only accommodate men. They don't have a place where they can accommodate women. They don't have separate washrooms. They don't have a separate kitchen for them. They don't have a separate area where they can, you know, recite Quran comfortably and pray comfortably. Then they have the right to say no. But if the accommodations are there, then a woman should not be refused. Sometimes a family says a woman is not supposed to do i'tikaf. This is a clear evidence that she can. But definitely you need the permission from your family.